Okay, well, thank you very much for inviting me. It's really an honor and a pleasure to be lecturing here. I am going to get used to, first of all, to this sound, but I'm going to talk about psychopathology. And the organizers asked me to present something that is easy to follow for everyone. That's not very difficult for me because the things that I do are not really that complicated. I'll come back to this later on. I would need to have a thing like this. So what are we going to talk about? About how nuts are the Dutch? About the data cube? About the hazards of a Luna Park? About the heart? And about the chicken and the egg? I will start with expressing some doubts. Well, another way to show it is like this. I'll talk about disorders, mental disorders, and the DSM box set method, and I'll explain what that is. I will present an alternative, and if there is time, I will tell you about why I'm here at psychology department and what my future plans are here. Let me start with this. Before the 50s, we didn't have mental disorders as we have them now. In biblical terms, the land of psychopathology was empty and barren, and then the American Psychiatric Association filled this barren landscape, and they made something light. Something appeared. And this was called the DSM. From now on, we had structure, and we could think about psychopathology, and we could discuss different forms of psychopathology with different professionals amongst each other. There were actually quite a lot of disorders that were invented at that time. And when they started, there were 106 in DSM-1. DSM-2 had more. And even now in DSM-5, we have 400 disorders. You can debate about the real number of disorders, and actually there is a discussion about how many disorders are actually being described in DSM, because you have also severity levels, you have specifiers, but let's put it at 400 at least. Well, how did they make such a number of disorders? How were all of a sudden, 30, 40 years ago, you didn't have depression, but then all of a sudden you had depression? How did they do that? Well, for that we have to go to a list of abbreviations, and that's called the Alboa list, a whole bunch of abbreviations. And in that list, there are all kinds of abbreviations for procedures. And when you go to the bottom one, we have the box set method, a bunch of old guys sitting around a table. This may sound funny, and actually it is, of course, but many decisions in this world are based on the box set method. Companies are run by gentlemen, even the Pope, when the Pope is being elected, somehow this induces all kinds of biblical associations. When the Pope is being elected, a group of older gentlemen come together, and when the smoke comes out of the chimney, then they have decided who is going to be the new Pope. This is a bit the same with the DSM method. And that's in principle, that's fine with me, but the problem that you may have with it is that maybe this group of older gentlemen is not really well informed, or is not really representative of the general population. Take, for example, homosexuality. Ola was talking about it just before the break. Homosexuality was actually in a DSM as a mental disorder, and not in the old age, but until the 70s it was considered a mental disorder. First it was headed under the bigger group of paraphilia together with pedophilia. Then it was considered a sexual orientation disorder. Then it became something strange, which was called ego-dystonic homosexuality. That means that in principle it's okay to be homosexual, but not if you have a problem with it. Then it's a disorder. And then people said, yeah, but it's the same with short people. It's fine to be short, but if you have a problem with it, then you have a low length disorder or something like that. So finally, they kicked it out of the DSM in 1973, which is, of course, much later than the general audience would have liked it to be. And you may still see today the negative effects that such decisions may have in the society by stigmatizing homosexuals. My Vici research was on the possibility that perhaps depression is also such a mistake. When you look at how depression is defined, then you have to fulfill a list of criteria, 2 core symptoms, at least 7 out of total of 9, 5 of a total of 9. And when you look at it from an outside perspective, first of all, you can calculate that at least 270 profiles are fulfilling this strange algorithm. Second of all, it's not clear to me why there is a distinction between core symptoms and other symptoms. It is not clear to me why there is a cutoff of 5 and not a 6 or 7 or 4. It's not clear to me why a symptom like rumination is not in it, while I have never seen a person with a depression who is not ruminating. It is pretty strange that one disorder can produce opposite kind of symptoms, like weight gain or weight loss, sleeping too little, sleeping too much. And I don't have a feeling like how this could work. And the answer is, of course, the box set method. This is just all being invented and not particularly data-driven. Although the DSM calls itself Diagnostic Statistical Manual, it's not really diagnostic because it's classification. It's not really statistic because it is more evidence-based than evidence-based. And it's not really a manual because it doesn't say what you should do. So next version, I recommend them not to change the number, but to change the letters instead. So what did the diagnosis of depression bring us? 40 years of research and billions of euros and dollars of research. It did not bring a diagnostic test with what you can determine whether or not a person is depressed. And I'm actually glad that it didn't work, because what would happen if you have a blood test for depression and someone scores positive on that, and then the person says, yeah, but I don't feel bad. Yeah, that's not my concern. Your blood test is positive, so you must have a depression. It's a bit of an awkward situation where we are all doing research to validate the concept of depression, but if you would, then it would be a strange situation also. Thanks to the concept of depression, we have antidepressants, because once you have a disorder, you know that you have to treat it. So we have SSRIs, and we recently reviewed the efficacy of those SSRIs, and at this moment about 1 million people in the Dutch population are using them. So it's one of the top selling drugs in the world. These are the effect sizes. And the letters before, you see, there was a very strange observation, because on the top it's major depressive disorder, but then you have generalized anxiety disorder, panic disorder, social anxiety disorder, PTSD, obsessive compulsive disorder. These drugs work hardly, but they work equally well for everyone, for every disorder. And there are even many more disorders that are not listed here for which they are actually being prescribed. Well, how small is small? We have effect sizes of 0.3 after correcting for publication bias. Well, this is the smallest one, is an effect size of 0.5. And you can hardly, on an individual basis, determine who has had placebo or drug. On a whole group, you will find statistically significant findings, but I can assure you there are drugs who have effect sizes like 3. If you take statins, which are lowering your cholesterol, they are lowering your cholesterol with an effect size of 2.5 to 3. Depression is, antidepressants are much and much less effective than such kind of medications. This is a slide which you can probably not really identify what it means, but this is a study. I thought, well, if there is a concept like depression, then it should exist in the general population. So let's ask all kinds of questions related to depression to a general sample in the Dutch population. And we have one that is called Lifelines. So we have 75,000 people who filled in about 20 symptoms, of whom 9 the depression symptoms and 11 other symptoms, something like that. And we did a cluster analysis on those people to see if there would be one group of the population who would just have a pure depression. And the short answer to that is no, there wasn't any group. So what we do see is that about 60% of the population don't have any emotional symptoms. And then there are some subgroups. Some people, they have slight problems which are related to a physical condition. There are people with varying levels of anxiety and depression, but there is no single group who has a pure depression. And why is that important? Because we are doing all kinds of research comparing the brain volumes of depressed people with non-depressed. But in this depressed group, per definition, there are a lot of people who have other conditions as well. And those people are confounding the kind of results that you find in these studies. Case-control studies with a pure depression group are probably not possible because such people do not exist on a population level. That's a very strange thing to discover. This one you can probably also not read, but what it illustrates is that mental disorders in general are associated. If you have one, you are likely to have another one during your life, and it doesn't really matter which one. So if you have panic disorder, you have 13 times risk of having agoraphobia during your life. Or if you have ADHD, you have opposite defiant disorder, 15 times, 12 times as likely. So if you have one, then probably you have another one. And that's also, the more disorders you have, the bigger the chance you have that you have more than one, of course. So this is also an artifact being induced by the DSM. Now, this is a bit negative, but this comorbidity is also something positive, actually, because it may also be, at least for me, the solution how we should get rid of all these 400 different diagnoses. What I did was, based on these odds ratios that I just showed, we did a network model to show which disorders are more closely related to the other. Or, in other words, if you have one, which is the other one that you will most likely develop in your life. And what you see is two clusters. One consists of social anxiety disorder, panic, agoraphobia, specific phobia, generalized anxiety, and depression. We call those disorders internalizing. And we have substance abuse, conduct disorder, ADHD, intermittent explosive disorder, all kinds of things that if you are under stress, you do unpleasant things to other people. we call that externalizing. Then you have two different groups, and here we have psychotic experiences. They don't have much to do with the other disorders. Eating disorders don't have much to do with the other ones. Bipolar is very interesting, because if you are manic, you're probably closer to the externalizing, and if you are depressed, you're probably more closely to the internalizing. So this seems to suggest a kind of structure that might underlie those 400 different diagnoses. We also did it in a more formal way with a bifactor model, and there you can see also there is one general factor that explains the most of the comorbidity between disorders, but then three sub-factors, one internalizing, that's this one externalizing, this one, and then in between the different kinds of psychotic experiences. This could be a much easier way to present mental disorders than the 400 different disorders which are categorized in all kinds of very strange arbitrary ways. What I think is interesting about it is that you could maybe consider mental disorders not so much as disorders but as vulnerabilities that have different expressions during your life. So consider that you are born with a stress-sensitive system, and you have that means that you will have a higher risk of developing specific phobia. Specific phobia has a very early age of onset of 8. Most children will, if you will have specific phobia, you will have it during your childhood. But that could be an expression of this underlying vulnerability. Maybe later on during your life you will develop agoraphobia, or when you're an adult you will develop depression. But this could all be the expression of your sensitive stress mechanism. The other way around, in the externalizing, you could do the same kind of thing. This also would reduce the kind of stigma attached to mental disorders. So I would not like it that we say, well, we have one healthy part of the population and one other part who is ill, but we have different variations on this internalizing and externalizing continuum, and that would prevent these strange things that some people are considered to be mentally ill and others are not, but some are just extreme, are somewhere at the extreme end of a continuum that occurs across the whole population. So that's the first part of the alternative that I am thinking of for the DSM. So consider the underlying domains of psychopathology to represent lifetime vulnerabilities. It doesn't matter for the specific episodes, because, for example, what is the difference between major depression and generalized anxiety? There is no difference. If you have major depression, you have 85% risk of having generalized anxiety as well, and the other way around. So it doesn't really matter, and the drugs, by the way, are equally ineffective for both as well. So we make things much too complicated with 400 disorders. Within those, let's say, three domains of psychopathology, we could study what I would call symptom circuitries. So not so much the symptoms in isolation, but the interaction between symptoms. And I will show you something about that. That's not really very easy. Well, this is the point that the age of onset of different disorders are very different. So it could well be that what expresses itself in childhood, like specific phobia, will be the same kind of thing that occurs later on in life, but then in the form of agoraphobia, panic disorder, and depression. Okay, so based on the Hoe Gek Is NL data, or How Nuts Are the Dutch, we are doing research to see if we can come to symptom circuitries. So this is just an example. Consider someone is ruminating and cannot sleep well. Next day he will feel tired and can concentrate poorly. And because of the tiredness, this concentration even worsens. the next day he would feel very guilty because he cannot function very well at work and in the family, and as a result of that he becomes depressed. Now, for those who looked at the first slides, those are all symptoms of depression. And what DSM does is just counting those different symptoms. But this is much more informative, because if this would be the case for an individual, you would not treat the bad mood, you would not treat the guilt feelings, but you would probably start with preventing that this person ruminates. Or if you cannot do that, at least help him to sleep well, because if he doesn't, because if he sleeps well, then he doesn't feel tired and fatigued, and then this whole cascade will not pass along for this person. This is what clinical therapists, of course, do. I hope the clinical psychologists who are in here recognize this and agree with me that this is what you do in therapy, to clarify these symptom circuitries to people. Why is that not in DSM then? Why do we make such simplifications? Can we not just study in the whole domain of internalizing disorders if there are specific typical symptom circuitries, because then we know where to break those processes? Well, that's the kind of thing that we are planning to do with How Nuts Are the Dutch in the next several years. Okay. Well, if you want to do that, you have to do a different kind of research, because we are doing either studies with quite a lot of people and quite a lot of variables, but then only one time point, or maybe two time points, or we do intensive time series with one or two people and then a whole lot of time series. What we need to do is studies in which we have both a lot of people, a lot of variables, and a lot of time points. And this is what we have in How Nuts Are the Dutch. 600 people were so crazy to fill in daily diaries. Well, they were not crazy, of course. We are very grateful for them. 90 assessments, so three times a day they would fill in an electronic diary with 40 variables, and so we have a very rich data set where we can look at such symptom circuitries, if they are present in the general population, if we can see first. Well, I'll explain it in a different way. Why people were so crazy to fill these 90 assessments was, at the end, they would get a personal feedback from us. This was all automated, but they would get a network of their own functioning and of their own network of emotions. So they would know how their emotional landscape would look like. You would get it only if you would have at least 65 of the 90 assessments. So we have automated this, and by now we have 600 different models for 600 different people. And the next step we are going to do is to see if there are clusters of people that have similar circuitries. And that could provide a much nicer and empirical basis for disorders or for disturbed processes in persons. Brings me to the point, why did I move from UMCG to psychology? Because I could have done all this kind of research also at the UMCG, and I was starting there, and I had nice people to work with. Well, first of all, I took with me the nicest people. And then I integrated them with the people from developmental psychology, who are actually very smart, and who were among the first to realize this point, that individual correlations are not the same as intra-individual correlations. And actually, we should be interested as psychologists in what happens within persons and not between persons. This is an example where you see that depression and activity are negatively correlated, so more active people are in general less depressed. But suppose you have a depressed marathon runner and you would advise him to run even more. that's crazy. Or if you have a person here who is not doing a lot of activities because he is somatically ill and you would advise him to do even more physical exercise, that's as crazy as what we do now when we do research based on group level comparisons. And people here were among the first to realize that, really. So what I'm planning to do in the next couple of months, yesterday I finished the examination of my first introduction to developmental psychology, so now I have time to prepare for a grant, and in this grant I will try to see if you can identify a phenotype based on processes that go on in people. And I start with the internalizing spectrum because I have experience with that, and in my VD was about the relationship between depression and heart disease. What I would like to study is to see if there is a phenotype that you can define by temporal spirals. So take, for instance, people who are born with a heightened stress responsivity, which is a psychological phenomenon. Such people have low heart rate variability because their heart rate is high all the time. They have a higher risk of developing some kind of childhood psychopathology. They are more likely to have sedentary lifestyle and metabolic syndrome. Later on to develop atherosclerosis, on the other hand, to develop something like sickness behavior because they don't feel somatically well. There is a kind of spiral that goes on within these individuals that increases their lifetime risk of heart disease, like coronary heart disease, which is related to a higher risk of having depression. Depression has a higher risk of developing heart disease. Not responding to antidepressant medication has a higher risk of getting heart disease. Poor prognosis of your heart disease results in depression and vital exhaustion, and in the end you have something like heart failure and mortality. And maybe by using this longitudinal association, we will be able to make much more informative, valid, and empirical-based phenotypes of people. And this could be just one. And I'm very much intrigued by the fact that maybe this whole psychological part of this person and the heart disease are actually expressions of the same kind of thing. And this is the kind of thing that you can study with the kind of analysis that we are doing in developmental psychology, the non-linear time series. This is a nice, this is very nice to mention, because in 2012 there were two science papers of completely different topics, one on two different fish sorts in the ocean, where one is the prey and one is the predator. And what you can see is whenever one goes up, this is the prey fish, then the predator follows that, and because of the fact that this predator follows, the prey fish decreases, and later on it recovers again. These kind of prey-predator models, maybe it's the same with depression and heart disease. Maybe the depression goes up and then the heart disease goes up again, and then you have to recover from that. Maybe they are just two parts of one system, and those prey-predator models, they are considering two time series as part of one system. And maybe we should look at time series components where you can already predict what is going to be wrong. Maybe in this case it was about greenhouse ice house transitions, and Martin Scheffer showed that even before the onset of the ice house phase, you could see by the levels of this funny thing in stones, which I don't recall what it was anymore, but you can see in carbon dioxide levels in stones already fluctuations before it really went to the sky. And these kind of fluctuations we can also study in time series in individuals to see, maybe you can see variations before a real onset to a depression, or maybe even to onset of heart disease. And that's the kind of thing that I would like to do in the next few months. So I thank you very much for your attention. And if there is anyone who would like to think on this topic with me in the next few months, I would be very grateful. Thank you very much.